Hello everyone, this is Gary from Fantastic Fundas, and in this lecture we are going to study about the Governor Generals, right? Because it has been quite a long time and so much has happened. I hope by now you are aware of the method in which I am teaching. I am running the two streams of teaching, okay? It's like two rivers, one flow, one of the rivers contain all the Governor Generals now, and one is the other happenings. Normally the things here onwards would be covered under the other happenings only. Right, for example, we talked about the moderate, the Congress, the extremists, the revolutionary nationalists, the Gadar, the Home Rule League, all those things. And now the other stream is of the Governor Generals. It won't contain much because here onward most of the things have been already covered anyway. So beginning with the today's lecture, we are going to cover two Governor Generals only in this lecture. Number one is the Lord Minto. This is obviously Minto 2. This is not the Minto which was earlier there, of course, right? And this Minto was from 1905 to 1900. 10 okay, and at his time, I'll just mention a few important things that happened, okay. At his time, Indian Muslim League was formed, okay. Indian Muslim League, we'll talk about the details of this in the lecture related to this. Communalism, okay, not over here. And similarly, you know, like all this few things which are related to communalism, somehow we'll talk about those, okay. So Indian Muslim League was formed there, right? And in fact, for this, just to give you a reference, that Nawab Salimullah, okay, Nawab Salimullah, he hosted a conference at Dhaka, okay. So that is how it was. And then, you know, All India Mohammedan Summit was held. All India Mohammedan Summit, right, I'll just write the short form. The summit was held, okay, and then after this, it was presided over by Vegar Mulk, something like that. I'm unable to recall the correct name. You can just mention in the comment section, Vegar Mulk, something like that. Anyway, you know, whatever his name was, it will correctly, you know, I'll just talk about this detail in the next lecture, not this one, right? And then there came the Morley Minto reforms also of the 1909, Morley Minto reforms. That I will just cover with you in a few seconds. Let me just mention quickly what other things was done at this time, right? And this Morley Minto reform, which resulted in the Indian Council Act of 1909, right? And all the separate electorates and the policy of divide and rule and all that story, that will be I talked about very just let me finish all the rest of the things of Morley Minto, because this I'll be doing in little more detail, okay? And what more happened during this period from 1905 to 1910, because there can be a question asked in paper. For example, who was the Governor General of India when the Surat split happened? Simple question can be asked in your paper. That is why the Governor Generals are important for you. So Surat split happened, right? And then, you know, there was also, you know, resolution for Swaraj was passed, if you remember, in 1906, right? Now the resolution was Swaraj, right? And 1906, that was Calcutta session, right? And then after that came the in fact, the announcement of the partition of Bengal was made under Curzon, but over here it actually happened. And I remember this date, 16 October 1905, on this day there was partition of Bengal, okay. And then after this there was one Arundale committee, okay. Arundale committee, and it was on the political reforms, okay. And at this time only Satendra Sinha, he became the member of the Governor General Council. So that was like about Minto 2. Now let me tell you about the details of this Indian Council Act that came at the time of Minto 2, okay. So this becomes important for us. This is Indian Council Act of 1909. I hope you remember the earlier acts, okay. I will try to do one lecture later on which will cover all the acts together, but for now it's just a probability, okay. I will try my best to do that, okay. So now let's begin with this this act, Indian Council Act, okay. So Morley, right? Morley was the second. These are also known as the Morley Minto reforms, right? So there were two people, the Morley and the Minto. These were the two people because of which we also have the present problem of communalism in India. We have Hindu fighting Muslims, okay. That this is the who's the real person because of which this is happening. Of course it is us. We should also think of ourselves. We are ourselves responsible, whether Hindus or Muslims. We both are responsible. But the origin of it, the main person, the father of this evil, of this Satan in our country, it is this Morley Minto reform. So I'll tell you how it happened. this person Morley, he was the secretary of the state. I told you there has to be one secretary of the state, and this person Minto was the governor general. Okay, now what happened just before the Morley Minto reforms came, I would like to give you a little background of it. Okay, there was a very important event actually, which is known as the Shimla deportation. Please remember the Shimla deportation, okay, because this will be referred again and again in coming times. So what had happened under the Shimla deportation was that there was a group of Muslim elites. Okay, it was not that all the Muslim were there, the Muslim elites, and they were led by a person known as the Aga Khan. And under them, under him, you know, they went to Minto. Minto was enjoying his drinks at Shimla. Okay, and this person Aga also went to him, that Mr. Minto, why are you enjoying it all alone? We also should have tea together. They had tea together, and they were talking. See, I have been to the place where they met, and you have to really feel the place, okay? Whenever, if you get an opportunity, you must go to these places, the historical places. Anyway, so they met Minto and asked him for a few things. They said, okay, now give us separate electorates. So such a thing happened. Okay, this is tragic actually, because there were people who were looking for separate electorates, right? Then second thing is a representation in excess of their numerical strength, because Muslims were making to the defense of empire. They said, because Muslims are protecting the empire, so we should get a representation, which they eventually get also in reality. Okay, they get a representation greater than in excess of their numerical strength. That this is what they demanded over there, right? With due respect to the person who, you know, who's having sympathy with these people who, you know, who thinks little fanatically about religion, I don't mean to offend any one of you. This is what the history is, right? And I'm just giving you a very neutral view of everything, of the history. Okay, there is a lot of criticism about the and the Hindu communalism also, when I talk to you about the communalism, right? So we'll do that in a separate chapter anyway. So the same group, you know, this group which was led by Aga Khan, this also takes over the Muslim League in 1906, right? And now when these people 1906, now when these people these people had actually two aims, right? And this Muslim League over here, right? First of all, to preach the loyalty to the empire, okay? Because because this is being dominated by people who are already looking for separate electorates. What do you mean by separate electorates? Oh yes, it means that in a constituency where elections are being held, only a Muslim will stand, okay? And only the Muslims will vote. So you know, assuring that there is only a Muslim candidate who is elected, right? So they would preach loyalty to the empire, right? Number one, that is what they wanted to promote, and number two was to keep the Muslim intelligentsia away from the Congress. Okay, they had this irritation from the Congress. Okay, so thus the Morley Minto reforms in came, and one of the most important, there were like two things, right? The first thing that is important about the Morley Minto reforms is that they increase the members, right? They increase the elective members and the nominated members also, right? Elected and nominated members to the Imperial Legislative Council, okay? And then also the Provincial Legislative Council. Imperial Legislative Council is like the center making the law. Provincial Legislative Councils, for each province of the under the British, there was a different legislative council, okay? So what was the rule that the most members, they were still getting elected indirectly, in fact, right? If you read about it, then, you know, at the Imperial Legislative Council, now there is a little dispute about these stats I'm going to share with you. This is not to be written in paper, okay, because NCRT mentions different stats, and there is various books mentioning different stats, okay? So don't go by it. You don't have to write this statistic that I'm going to mention in your paper. It is just for your reference to help you understand that how the Morley Minto reform or the Indian Council Act of 2000 and of 1909, it was merely an empty vessel, okay? So how it was, okay? So there was Imperial Legislative Council. In all, this Imperial Legislative Council, it had 69 members. According to some books, it had 68 members. So whatever you want to believe, you may do that, right? Okay, so I would rather stick to the this division of 68 rather than 69, right? Because NCRT also talks about 68 members, right? And then, you know, there were out of these 68 members, there were 36 official members and 32 were the non-official members, okay? And out of this 36 over here, you know, there were 9 members who were to be ex-officio members, okay? For example, the Governor General, and you know, it would have 7 ordinary members, and you know, for example, the Executive Committee members, okay? And then there was one extraordinary member. That is how it was. 7 executive members were there, 7 ordinary members plus 1 extraordinary member plus the Governor General. It made 9 over here. So, and then, you know, the remaining rest, right, the 27 over here, it was like some, okay, this over here, it was, there, some of them were nominated by Governor General and all that story. So, there was a lot of nomination involved. That is how it went, right? Please do not, I don't want to discuss this anyone with you. I won't be replying to your comment on this particular thing. In general, I will be replying to you, but not on this particular thing. This is just to help you understand how the situation was. This is not to be written in your paper, not to be remembered. I'm telling you, no one is going to ask you this thing ever, okay? So there were like 32 members otherwise were there, which were the non-official members, right? 36 over there were the official, these were the non-official members. And out of these 32, you know, 5 members, they were nominated members, okay? The 5 were nominated, and the remaining, right, 27 members are remaining. So, you know, in these 27 also, okay, they were elected members. But then, you know, in the election of these also, there were a lot of reservation. For example, there was a reservation for Muslim landlords and capitalists who were loyalists. So you know, this was like class denominated determined thing happening over here. So capitalists, such people were here. So basically, what I really want to show, that you, how will you write this point in your paper? You will just say there was increase in number, the elected and the nominated members at the Legislative Council and at the Provincial Legislative Council, it was expanded. Yet British continued with their control on it because of the way the seats were divided among the various people. That is how you just write it, right? Then, you know, after this, yeah, okay, before that, you know, see, basically what I'm trying to suggest you, that the number of elected members, okay, that was increased. But then, you know, the elected members, they were not elected directly. They were the elected members, they were increased, okay? Now, but these members were elected indirectly. So Britishers were effectively having their control in spite of this increase in the representation, okay? I mean, you know, see what is happening, for example, you know, if you talk about the Provincial Council, that was, this is about the Imperial Legislative Council. But if I talk to you about the Provincial Legislative Council, what was happening there, let's have a look there, okay? What's happening in the Provincial Legislative Council, see, there are two kind of, you know, non-official members were there, okay? There were non-official members were there, two kinds were there, right? One was the nominated member, okay, and other was the elected member. See, when it comes to nominated, overall, you know, it was basically non-elected members only. They form the majority, and using this majority, Britishers controlled, right? And these elected members for the Provincial Legislative Council, see, they were indirectly elected, as I just told you. And the local bodies, basically, you know, the local bodies, these elected the members. That is why I'm calling it indirect election, right? So, and in these Provincial Legislative Council members also had role in electing the members of the Imperial Legislative Council. So some role was there also, right? You need not know more than this, because it would be then unnecessary detail. Otherwise, there are books after books which have just gone into tremendous detail regarding this. There were this many member there, these many member there. That's all unwanted, unnecessary, okay? Right? So basically, you know, I just want to tell you what really you have to write in your paper is that the reformed councils, okay, so-called reformed councils, because they were reformed as per the Britishers, the reformed councils, they had no real power, okay? Asli mein to koi taakat hi nahi thi unke paas. They were merely advisory bodies. They had no actual power with them, okay? And then, you know, these reforms brought no change, okay? And because they remained undemocratic, they remained foreign in character, and they did not help in finishing the economic exploitation. It did not help in any way, okay? In fact, they were not even designed to democratize Indian constitution. And the proof of it is that there is a quotation by Lord Morley, and you don't have to write this quotation, this is just to help you understand that how these constitution detail were not focused at all in democratization, okay? He said, if it could be said that this chapter of reforms, it led directly or necessarily to the establishment of parliamentary system in India, I for one would have nothing to do for it. This is what Morley said, that I for one would have nothing to do for it. I for one. That means Morley was clear in his mind that he's not here to help the Indians, okay? And then, you know, there was just one more reform, that in the Governor General's Executive Council, okay, we talked about this in the earlier act, in the Governor General's Executive Council, there was now one Indian included, okay? There was introduction of an Indian. So, right, there were like few smaller details also happening, smaller changes happening. For example, the members could introduce the new resolutions, okay? The new resolutions could be introduced by them, and then, you know, the powers of the legislature were enlarged to a certain extent. For example, they could pass the resolution, as I said, this resolution, but then it may or may not be accepted, right? May be accepted or may not be accepted. That is how it was, right? And then they could ask questions, right? In the parliament, okay, Imperial Legislative Council, okay, and they could vote on the specific items in the budget. Basically, they could not vote the whole budget, but they could there were few items on which could be voted. Earlier, the budget was not even votable, right? And this part, this power of asking questions increased. And then, you know, Britishers also, through the Governor General, this Indian Council Act of 1909, introduced something tragic, for which I called the Morley Minto as the villain of India. In fact, it is because of this reason, because of Morley Minto, that we are still suffering to this date because of the cancer of communalism, okay? And what was that? That was separate electorates, okay? I have already explained to you the meaning of separate electorates, but I would go in a little more depth with this, okay, they basically wanted to encourage the notion that social, economic, political, cultural, whatever it be, you know, the social, economic, political, cultural of Hindus and Muslims were not same, right? They were not common. In fact, they were different. This is what Britishers said. But I don't know, how is this possible? Think for yourself, if you are a Muslim or a Hindu, if you are a religious person, how can the social, economic interest, political interest, or cultural interest of Hindus and Muslims can be different, right? They can be same, right? There is no reason that they should be different. In fact, you know, through how the separate electorates were introduced, they were discriminatory electorates, okay? For at the provincial level, what happened, that at the provincial level, there were three categories introduced, and that was general category, special category, and chamber of commerce category for electing the members, okay? And then at the central level, there were again, there were four categories. These three as it is, okay, these three were same, and then plus there was one more, the Muslim category was added. That way, okay, you know, this is the introduction of the separate electorates in through the 1909 Act, right? And please remember, this question has been asked. Question asked in your prelim exam and main exam is very simple, okay? It won't be this complicated. This is just to help you understand and appreciate the history better and understand the situation better, that what really was happening, okay? This is just for that help. Please do not go into unwanted details, okay? So you know, to sum it up, the system of this separate electorate, actually it was based on the notion, right, so that our interest, they and their interest, the Hindus and our, you know, I mean the Muslims and the Hindus interest, they are different, okay? And then and the notion, see, I'm telling you that this notion was unscientific, that socio-economic political interests are different. This notion was unscientific, okay? Unscientific, whatever the spelling be, you can correct it. Because a religion cannot be a base, for political or economic interest of the people, okay, of the political groupings. So it cannot be based on this. After all, we are humans only. We Muslims eat the same chapati as the Hindus. They both eat the same roti. Okay. And then the Muslims also got more representation than their population, as they were asked in Shimla deputation also, okay. And see, even this thing, that see how they are differentiating, how the British are trying to divide and rule India. There was an income qualification for voting, okay. If you have certain income, only then you could vote. And what happened? The thing that the number of people, this income, minimum income, it was kept low for the Muslim, just to see how they are trying to divide Indians, these Britishers, okay. It is because of them we are suffering so much even to this state. Okay, so they kept low and we are suffering, right? They kept low as a, for the Muslims. Now, there was one Indian in, as I told you now, Viceroy's executive council, okay, the person who reached there, okay, and executive council, I mean, you know, it's like the council of ministers today, something like that, okay, and his name was the Satendra Sinha, okay, Satendra Sinha. He was there, and then, you know, there was no element of democracy there in this moral elemental reforms, and they were merely advisory bodies, okay. And the real purpose, they were just advisory bodies, let me just write this word. The real purpose of the moral elemental reform was very different, actually. They did not want to help Indians. All they wanted to do was to check the nationalist movement in India, to divide the Hindus and Muslims, so that there is no unity on the basis of religion. People were divided, and then, you know, the real purpose, it was to confuse the moderates, which they successfully did also to great extent, confuse the moderates, okay. That is what their target was, and to check the unity that was growing among the Indians. These people, these moral elemental reform, they had great weaknesses. I mean, there were, like, you know, narrow franchise system. Then what more weaknesses were there? There were indirect elections. I mean, what use are these indirect elections? Suppose, you know, you have to choose the prime minister of your country. If this Modi was chosen indirectly, what would have happened? Okay, and then, you know, legislative power councils, this imperial legislative council and the provincial legislative council, they had very limited powers. You can talk about budget was so limited. So they had a limited powers. That's like another criticism of this act, right? Please understand, you know, how this really led to divisions in Indian society. For example, Muslims, you know, there are other communities started resenting in India that you know, this distinction has been made, and because Muslims of the few of the Muslims, not all the Muslims, right? Not all Muslims are bad, and just like not all Hindus are good, same way, right? Not everyone is good or bad. It's actually nothing to do with the religion. These people are there for their selfish motives, right? So same goes for the Sikhs and the other religions, right? So what happened, that those Muslims, which particularly claimed, led by Aga Khan, they said that we gave better service to empire. Now this was contested by many other people. Others said, only you gave the service to empire, we also gave the great service to the empire. And yet, you know, it had not been they had not been shown any special consideration. And the Sikh also said that, and they fought for their rights, okay. And in 1919, even the Sikhs got the special representation, right? This is how the things are deteriorating. Now, after Sikhs got it, others also started revolting against this. For example, the Harijans started saying, and then the Indian Christians also started fighting for their part of the reservation. That is how, you know, the things kept on getting worse. Then the Europeans in India, they also started saying that we are fighting for you, give us reservation. And then there were Anglo-Indians who also started talking about all this. So everyone, right, it just started with the Muslims and the Sikhs and the Harijans and Christians and Europeans and the Anglo-Indians, everyone they got. And by the time there came the representation, they all got separate representation by the Government of India Act of 1935. Like, most of them actually got it, right? Now, that national unity, which was the result of the centuries, humne sadiyan bita di sabko jodne ke liye, kya hua? What happened to my country because of these bloody moral mementos? Huh? They are the real villains, okay? And we have to suffer because of them even today, right? See, even when, you know, the bill was introduced, Morley made it clear, right, that he had no intention of setting up parliamentary system in India, right? And, you know, he said it, that when parliamentary forms were introduced, and, you know, they introduced no responsibility to India. They, okay, even if you say that they gave some seats to everyone, and that is how the British were advancing, but then they gave no seats to India. So it was a power without responsibility, okay? There no responsibility was given. That is how it was, right? In fact, the system of the whole election, it was so indirect that the representation of the people was hardly there. It was so indirect. They were not the real representative of the people, right? So, in all, the 1900 reforms, they granted the influence, okay? There may be some influence was there, but they did not give any kind of power. That was about the Morley Minto reforms, right? And now, after, so now we begin with Hardinge II, 1910 to 1906, because that was all about the Minto, okay? Yeah, apart from, yeah, there's just like one little more thing about the Minto where I'll just mention this one. We've already done this actually, right? I hope you remember that. India House, okay, Shyamji Krishna Verma, and then also the activities of Madanlal Dhingra. Okay, and then that Alipur bomb case, okay, and Alipur bomb case is the same one in which the Kingsford was killed, right, by Khudiram Bose and Praful Chakki. In fact, he was attacked, not killed, right? And then, you know, the Nasik conspiracy case, related to Savarkar. I discussed that in quite a detail with you, So that has been already done, okay. So now what we do, we come back over here to Hardinge 2, okay. So, Hardinge II from 1910 to 1916, and there's so much regarding Hardinge II that it'll take some time before this lecture ends now. So, let's begin with this. This man was a little bit sympathetic towards Indians, right? Obviously, he cannot be much sympathetic, and he really wanted to win the heart of the Indians. You know, he was such a loving person. He will show his lovingness to you in just few more minutes. He'll tell you what kind of foolishness he committed against the Indians. At his time, you know, there was like Delhi Darbar was done, okay? Delhi Darbar was done at his time in 1911, Delhi Darbar. And in this Darbar, what was this Darbar actually really about? What had really happened that in 1910, before this the Darbar was held, there was a succession happening in England, right? And the king there, the name of the king was King George V. Many of you might be having even the coins of that time. I have at my place one or two coins, maybe, you know, of King, with King George V stamp on it, right? Most of the people do, at least in this part of the country, right? Anyway, so in 1911, then he comes to India, okay, and. In fact, I have the coin with me of the is exactly when he came to India of 1911 only. Anyway, right? So when he came to India, there was the coronation to be happened of King George V and also the Queen Mary as as emperor and the empress. Okay, Queen Mary. Okay, and that's how it went, right? And this Darbar, it was so grand that it reminded people of the Mughal era. Now, though it reminded people of the Mughal era, but also people had just suffered so many famines, people were dying, there were disease spreading, there were wars happening. I mean, come on, there were so many deaths happening, so much of poverty in India, and what are you doing celebrating it? Lakhs of people attended this coronation, okay? But then it was highly criticized by the Congress for its pomp and all the celebration, okay? And in this Darbar only, it was declared that the capital of India will be shifted from from Calcutta to India. This was through this Darbar only, Calcutta to Delhi, right? That's how it was decided. Now, here it was decided. And then, you know, it was in this Darbar only it was held, which was good thing. The partition of Bengal is cancelled. So, itna sara jo, itna, you know, all that trouble that was created is ended here. And in this year only, there was another census of India carried out, right? Anyway, so that was about the Delhi Darbar of 1911. There have been questions asked on it, the very simple questions. These are the few informations which have been asked, right? Partition of Bengal, the census, the capital, and there's criticism and coronation and all the story, right? Nothing more than this. And then after this, then you know there was what is known as the Delhi Delhi conspiracy case. Okay, Delhi conspiracy case. So far we have done few conspiracies. I hope you remember them, right? We did the Nasik conspiracy. Nasik, I told you the whole story. So I hope you remember that, how it was related to Veer Savarkar. That's one, right? And then the number one and number two, Alipur conspiracy, Alipur bomb conspiracy, or Ali conspiracy trial, whatever you want to call it. This was related to the Praful Chakki and Khudiram Bose. Okay. This very interesting fact, actually, I added also in the comment section, in the detail section of the earlier video, this thing that the policeman, you know, who arrested Khudiram Bose, because you know, one of them, Praful Chakki, committed suicide. Khudiram Bose was arrested. So you know, the person who arrested him, that person, that Indian police wala, his name was Nandlal Banerjee. Okay, and then this police wala was also shot down dead by Narendranath Bhattacharya. So anyway, that is a different story. That's just side reference. You can just leave it. Anyway, now what happened at the Delhi conspiracy case, and this was in 1912 happening, right? So there were like you know, in Bengal there were many you know, these samitis. Okay, for example, I talked to you about Anushilan Samiti and the Yugantar. So this is the story related to Yugantar, okay? And these were started as this, even Anushilan, they were started as a fitness club. The gym ki tarah shuru hue the na, and as gyms, right? So in Yugantar there were a few people involved. For example, I have already talked to you, I hope you remember this, right? Aurobindo Ghosh, right? And then his brother was there, Barin Ghosh, and Raja Subodh Malik was there. Raja Subodh Malik was there, right? And then Khudiram Bose was also involved in this. Okay, and Khudiram Bose, okay, though he was arrested, right? But then, you know, so he was indirectly involved in it, right? And then So many people were involved. Actually, this was made earlier, right? It's not now. Before the arrest, it was made. So that is why people like this are around. And Praful Chakki was also involved in the two people who were involved in the Alipur conspiracy trial, right? So this like they were involved this because this was formed much before the Delhi conspiracy or their arrest in, you know, at the time when they attacked the King's Fort, right? So what happens in here that you know, this Alipur bomb case trials had happened, right? And people were sent to the castles of Kalapani, right? They were sent to Andaman Nicobar, and from then there, you know, people sent to Kalapani, and then, you know, there came the general amnesty and the people were released in 1920 after the World War. That is what happened. So out of these people, there was another important person whose name who was released from this. The name is Ras Bihari Ghosh. We have already talked much about him, so I'll tell you more, right? So Ras Bihari Ghosh, right, the after what happened, the Alipur Bombay case, you know, and this Alipur conspiracy trial, he left, you know, Bengal, right? And he started working in Dehradun. This person, Ras Bihari Ghosh, he started working at Dehradun at FRI. Oh, I have like few friends living there. It's a beautiful place, okay? You just have to stay there sometime to really understand that place. Anyway, right, it's for people who have Indian Forest Service. They live in IGNFA, Indira Gandhi National Forest Academy. It is a beautiful service, and if you qualify for it, please do write this exam. Do not miss this exam, okay? And then this service, okay? Anyway, so the FRI campus is next to IGNFA, very near to it, right? So so he started working in FRI, this person Ras Bihari Ghosh, at Dehradun, right? And then what happened that there was an accusation on Ras Bihari Ghosh that Delhi conspiracy, about which we are going to now talk to you, it was conspired by him. So what happened in Delhi conspiracy? See, you already know this, actually, okay? In this, what had happened, there was a bomb attack, okay? On whom? On Lord Hardinge. We have already done this while he was driving on the elephant, okay? And but then, you know, in bomb, this person was not killed, Hardinge, but his elephant driver was killed. And but then in this case, Ras Bihari Ghosh, the accusation was there on this man, that in this Delhi conspiracy case, but it was never proven that it was him who was involved in this case. So what happens now that Ras Bihari Ghosh, he went underground, and then, you know, this person Ras Bihari Ghosh, he goes, Britishers are trying to destroy all the underground activity, right? So what happens, this Ras Bihari Ghosh, he goes to Japan, Okay, Japan, as the word is pronounced, right? So he flees there, and then you know he lives there until, in fact, up to Second World War. He lives in Japan, right? And before fleeing to Japan, he was involved in a Ghadar conspiracy also. Okay, we have already done this thing. I hope you remember this. Okay, and in fact, Ghadar conspiracy. You know, in that Lala Hardayal, who was one of the main people in this Ghadar conspiracy, he was greatly inspired by Raj Bihari Ghosh's act of throwing a bomb on Lord Hardinge, right? And then you know, in this the trial was held in Delhi conspiracy case, and in this case, though Raj Bihari Ghosh has flees to Japan, and but then you know in India there were few people who were convicted and executed in India. No one talks about these people. Okay, everyone talks about just the few people, right? And but these are the unsung heroes of our history. Please try to remember them, not for your exam. Okay, these are the people because of whom we are free today. Okay, otherwise many of us would be working for Britishers today. Right. Okay. Anyway, so who are those people? They were, you know, everyone. For example, Basant Kumar Vishwas was there. Basant Kumar Vishwas. He died for his country. Right. Amir Chand. He died for his country. Innumerous. I mean, you cannot just count them. So many people. Awadh Bihari. He was executed for this. Okay, so these are the people who died for us. Okay, for you, for me. Please remember their names for the you know sake of your country. That is how you know that of course will help you in your exam. Now, Basant Kumar Vishwas was there, Amir Chand was there, and Awadh Bihari was there. Okay, I hope you remember them, right? And then you know this Delhi conspiracy case. This is also known as the Delhi Lahore conspiracy case or the Hardinge bomb case, right? All that. Okay, so that was pretty much about the Delhi conspiracy case. And you know, when this person Raj Bihari Ghosh, he went to Japan, and over there he also gets in touch with the Indian National Army. He had a big role in that also. Anyway, so at this time only there are few more the revolutionary nationalists involved. Okay, we have done a lot of revolutionary nationalists in the earlier lecture itself, but at that there were few more. Okay, I came across them, so I thought these are important ones. See, the number is in thousands. I'm just giving you the name of the few hundred only. Okay, it's not even few hundred, just few tens of them. Not even 100 names are there in total if you see the list. Okay, so there was Raj Bihari Ghosh. As I told you, he was involved. Raj Bihari Ghosh, he came as the link between the people of Punjab and Bengal, right? For this Ghadar movement, and he also fled to Japan. And Japan, when he went to Japan, he also founded there the Indian Independence League. There, Indian Independence League was founded by Raj Bihari Ghosh in Japan. Okay, Indian Independence League at Japan. That is the important part. Then you know, there were a lot of other people. For example, there was Bipin Bihari Ganguly. Okay, Bipin Bihari Ganguly. Don't be scared by these names. These names just might be asked in your paper. Try to appreciate them, try to love them, try to understand their contribution to your freedom. Okay, that is, if you connect yourself emotionally to these people, it will be easy for you to remember them. Okay, so Bipin Bihari Ganguly, BBG. So BBG, he was involved in what? Atma Unnati Samiti. Atma Unnati. Okay, Atma Unnati Samiti. That means self-development Samiti, right? And then there was J.M. Chatterjee. Okay, he was there. He founded the Bharat Mata Society. Bharat Mata Society. There was one Bharat Mata, something like society, something was founded in Punjab also. Okay, but then you know, this was in Saharanpur. It's everywhere. Don't think that only people from Bengal, Punjab or Maharashtra were working for independence. All over India now people were getting aware. Okay, and then after that there was something in Deccan, you know, there was in Madras province. Okay, there in Madras province there were two important leaders. Their name was, one was Neelkanth, okay, Neelkanth Brahmachari, That was one person over there in Madras. Say these names out loud. Speak them with me. Write them everywhere. Just try to remember as many as you can. Then you will score good in your history. History mein aise nahi number aate. Not everyone scores well in history. This is the reason I'm telling you. Not everyone writes. See, you in history answer, you must write two things. One is the story, one is the facts. You get number when you write both the things, okay? And then also in South India, there was a Vanchi Ayyar, okay? These two people, they founded the secret Bharat Mata Association, okay? Secret Bharat Mata Association. If you're laughing on this, you know, it's really a sad situation because these people died for, you know, us people only, right? Then, you know, there was also in Bengal, okay, there was Dhaka Anushilan Samiti. Dhaka Anushilan Samiti. What was in this? It was established by somebody called Pulin Bihari Das. Okay, this was a huge organization. So, you know, all these were there, all these militant revolutionaries were there, okay. And then after this, you know, I would like to talk to you about Banaras Hindu University Act. Now, although I have done this act in quite a detail over here, right, Banaras Hindu University Act of 1915, we have done a whole lecture on the education of India, but I guess this was not done in so much of detail, the Banaras Hindu University. And this, I don't know, I just have an understanding that this question is pending for a long time in UPSC. This just might be asked in your paper, so please understand. And this is not just for 1 year, okay, this is like all for, at least for next 5-6 years, this question is very important, right? Banaras Hindu University Act, it might remain important after that also. So what happens that there was a person known as Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya ji, okay, and it was passed, this act was passed in 1915, and you know, it in under, because of this act, Banaras Hindu University was formed, right? And because of the contribution of Madan Mohan Malviya ji, this could be done, right? And the idea of the idea of having this university, it all started in 1904. And actually, Madan Mohan Malviya ji, he was a barrister. He was a very well educated person from England, right? I mean, you know, he was a barrister, and then he was from Allahabad. And second thing is, just in case you're curious, right? But then, you know, all his life he had lived in Varanasi, and in 1907 he also met Annie Besant. Okay. Annie Besant's role has been tremendous in India. So Annie Besant, who also talked about establishing some kind of University of India, because without education you cannot really progress. So at Varanasi, okay, and she also submitted a memorandum for grant of royal charter. This is what Annie Besant is doing. What is she doing? She's submitting a memorandum for grant of royal charter for establishing the university, of course. For grant of royal charter, this is very important fact that you should be knowing, right? So what happened then? They finally, you know, in 1911, since they have been struggling for 4 years now, in 1911, Madan Mohan Malviya ji and Annie Besant ji, both of them, they decide that together they will work and form a Hindu university at Varanasi, Hindu university. Please, you know, lot of people have a very wrong thought process that just because it was named Hindu, it was a Hindu university. No, it had seats for Muslims also, Sikhs also. It was open to other religions also. Please understand that, okay? And similarly, you know, there was Aligarh Muslim University. There were Sanskrit classes also happening under the Aligarh Muslim University. These universities, these educational places were not communal as a lot of people claim them, okay? It's just because of the poor understanding of history of the people that it is said so, right? Now, what happens that initially in 1911, this Banaras Hindu University starts as a society. It's registered as a society, okay? And the president of the society is the Maharaja of Darbhanga. Maharaja of Darbhanga. So his name is Sir Rameshwar Singh Bahadur. Sir Rameshwar Singh Bahadur. So Sir Rameshwar Singh Bahadur, he was the president of the society. And what happens then, a huge money was needed for running this organization. 50 lakh rupees were needed at that time, right? It probably will be 500 crores today. Anyway, so this is how it went, right? And then, you know, for this university, and in fact, this amount of money was collected by 2015. And in this university, establishment of this university, there were Muslim contribution also. By no means, just because its name was Hindu University doesn't make it a Hindu, purely pure Hindu university. It was a secular university. Okay, in fact, there was earlier there was Central Hindu College, which was actually converted to the Banaras Hindu University. And then this the society becomes, by the Banaras Hindu University Act, which was introduced into the Imperial Legislative Council in 1915. Now that was introduced by a Britisher, and the name of the Britisher was Butler. Okay, Sir Butler. He introduced this law, and this university was made. Okay, and then in fact, Lord Hardinge himself laid the founding stone of this university. And please remember, Hardinge had a soft corner for Indians, right? In spite of him being a British citizen. You just cannot look to every Britisher, with an eye that he was a poor person, okay? It is the British government. It's not every British, every employee is bad of the British. It's just like, you just cannot say, for example, let's say there is Pakistan Army today, just to help you understand this better. Just because somebody is is a member of Pakistan Army, there must be somebody in Pakistan Army who would have some sort of soft corner for India. It's not that he will not fire when he's at the border. Even then, he will fire at the border. That, please try to understand. He would have some soft corner. Wherever possible, he would not like to kill an Indian soldier. That is my whole point. Same way with Indians, okay? Somewhere, because after all, we are humans. You just cannot ignore the fact. Don't try to be a jingoist, okay? There's an English word called jingoist. Don't try to be that. It is just, you just have a nationalistic tendency. That's it, right? Anyway, let's move ahead, finish the lecture. Then, came the Islington Mission, okay? Islington Commission of 1912. And this is related to the for development of the civil services. So this Islington Commission is related to civil services, and we have already done much of the detail about the civil services, but I would like to talk to you little about, I'll just give you a background of what all we have done so far regarding the civil services. You know this thing already, that initially the civil service servants were appointed by the court of directors of East India Company, right? But this practice continued right up to 1853, when by the Charter Act of 1853, this was abolished, right? And after 1853 Charter Act, there was examination process which was held, right? And the competition was thrown open to Indians also. And then, after this came the Macaulay Committee. Okay, and then it suggested that to it basically help in putting the provisions of 1853 Act in force, and to put into force the provisions of the 1853 Act. This Macaulay Commission, okay, this committee, this came in 1854, right? Then it said that the open system should be there for recruitment for the civil services. Okay, the open competition system. It's not that only the chosen ones could give the competition. Earlier it was that only few could give the paper. So now open competition exam, right? That should be there. And the age of the candidates, it was it was to be from like 18 to 23 years, right? And then the competitive exam, it was to be held in London. That is the condition was here. And then there would be some probationary period, for the people who were selected through the exam. And then abolition of Haileybury College. This was at a place called Haileybury in Britain, and it was East India College, right? Haileybury College, it was abolished, right? And the exam should be of very high standard. Now, I don't know about anything else, but UPSC seems to have taken this last suggestion of Macaulay Committee very seriously, having exam of high standard. Anyway, right? So that is how the things kept on going. And then, what happened, that for the first time, an open examination, which was held in London, it was in 1855, the first one was held. And then in 1855 only, the British Civil Services Commission was set up. Okay, British Civil Services Commission was set up, and slowly, the whole exam, this responsibility of holding the exam and everything was transferred to the commission. Okay, and the first Indian which passed through the exam. Okay, there has been some confusion in the earlier lecture. Let me just clear it forever. It was a Satyendra Anak Tagore. So Satyendranath Tagore was the first person, right? But he could enter service only in 1864, so that's quite late, right? And then before there also came this Indian Civil Services Act of 1861, and since then this has been of great importance to us, right? In 1861, the Indian Civil Service Act, with this it provided for the reservation of certain principal post only for the few people. Okay, basically talked about the reservation of senior posts, because Indians could not give, Britishers could not give a very senior post to the Indians over here, right? So basically in 1870 then came another act which talked about the Indianization of the services, right? And then after this 1870 act came the what is known as the Acheston, okay, A-I-T-C-H-I-S-T-O-N, Acheston Commission. And this Acheston Commission came in 1886, and this basically it provided us suggestions that how to do full justice. Okay, they wanted, Britishers also wanted to do justice to Indians, so-called justice. Okay, this is just a joke, right? Anyway, so they wanted to do full justice to the Indians' claims, okay, Indian claims to the higher services, or to full claim to the higher employment. That this is what the Britishers wanted to do to satisfy the Indian demands, right? And it said that this Acheston Commission that we were just talking, don't worry, this is like I have created a new screen. So this Acheston Commission, it suggested that these two services should be abolished, these two services. This is one of the covenanted services, other are the uncovenanted services. Let me just write it clearly. Uncovenanted service, these were the higher service and these were the lower services, and then these lower services, basically these are the higher up ranks and these were the lower ranks, and these were further divided into higher ranks, upper provincial and lower provincial service. That is how it was divided. Okay, that is this the word covenanted services and uncovenanted service, that is how the British Library defines it. So I just taken this from there. So he said that this system should be abolished, and now they shall be a three-tier system. What do you understand by three-tier system? First of all, at the top there would be imperial services, and then there would be provincial services, just like your UPSC and the state PCS, and then there would be subordinated services. Okay, this three-tier services concept was introduced by the Acheston Commission, and then they said that the maximum age for writing the exam was fixed at 23 years. This is tragic. Okay, anyway, the competitive exam, it was held, that because at that time it was parallelly held in India and England. They said no, exam should be held at, it should not be held simultaneously. This is what they said, right? And it said that some minimum number of percentage should be fixed of the people, of so that people of provincial services, they could be promoted to the higher services, right? And then there was statutory civil services, something called statutory civil services, that was also suggested to be abolished, statutory civil services. And it was indeed abolished by the Act of 1892. That is how it went, right? And then finally, after all this came at the time of Lord Hardinge, Islington Commission. And this was in 1915. Okay, we are in the 20th century. Now, this Islington Commission, it said that accepted the earlier things, and it said that the recruitment to the top post should be made partly in India and partly in England. Okay, so that exam should not be held parallel. That was solved through this way, that a top post, it should be filled through, exam partly in England and partly in India. That's what he suggested, right? And then even then he never said that this exam should be held parallel, but then he was just talking about the filling the top post. Okay, and then he said that the issue is basically of the top post only. That said that 25% of the top post, they should be filled by Indians. Okay, and how would Indians fill it? By directly by the exam or by the promotion. Now Imagine, right? There is some it kind of achievement of the moderates at that time, or let's say artists or whomsoever, of all the people put together, there is certain achievement in a certain way, right? And then the government services were classified over here. Government services were classified into a class one services and the class two services. Okay, you already know this, what it all means. Okay, you can always go search this thing, right? Anyway, this is because not related to history as such. And then, you know, it recommended a probation of 3 years for the ICS officers, okay, Indian civil servants, and then 2 years for the direct recruits, okay, 2 years for the direct ones. And that is how it went, right? And this commission's report, actually, this report, which was appointed in 15, it came in 1917, and this time World War I was going on and everyone was busy. So no one really took care, no one bothered about this report, and this report was then junked. Okay, this was not put, any consideration was not given to this. So that is pretty much about this Lord Hardinge, and there was like so many other things which we have already done, the Komagatamaru, the Gadar, and you know, there was a beginning of World War I also, and then you know, there was a lot of communalism also growing in India at this time, right? And there was this home rule movement. Okay, so communalism is one factor which is growing at this time, that I will talk to you in the next lecture as a separate lecture, in which I will talk to you about the rising communalism in India at that time. Okay, and then also there was Home Rule League happening at this time. Okay, and so those were the major things at the time of Hardinge, right? So next lecture, that as I said, it will be on the communalism, right? And I hope you are enjoying the series, and if you are, please do share it with others. And you can do this, just it's very easy. You just go to Facebook, or just click over down there in the comment section, you just click on the Facebook, and you can click on the like. That really helps me to understand if you are really liking the videos. And finally, if you want all these videos, whether history, polity, or all the future subjects, to come right into your email, then you will need to subscribe to us, and for this you have to click this button, right? So that is all, and thank you so much for watching this.